Good morning, guys. We are up to Chapter 7 of Bystander. Chapter 7 is titled Lunch. The problem with the cafeteria was this: where do you sit? Eric hadn't really thought about it until he stood there, food tray in his hands, inspecting the landscape. The room was huge, filled with rows of long tables. Even at a glance, Eric could guess the personalities of some of the tables. The jocks, the geeks, the popular girls, and so on. So where did Eric fit in? Nowhere. In class, you took a seat and sat there while the teacher rambled on. It wasn't a big lifestyle decision, but here in the lunchroom, there was no avoiding the reality that Eric didn't have a single friend in town. He was alone, and he didn't want to be. In a month, he assured himself, everything would be fine. He'd make new friends, sit with them, eat, joke, laugh. But right now, today, the first day of school, it all kind of sucked. But on another level, none of it really mattered. Eric could smell his meatball sub and he felt hungry. He wanted to eat. There was nothing complicated about that. So without thinking further, he grabbed a chair at the vacant end of a long table. A few minutes later, he heard a voice. "Dude, tell me you are not sitting all alone at this table." Eric looked up. It was Griffin Connolly, standing at Eric's left elbow. "Remember me?" Griffin said, shaggy hair falling into his eyes. Eric pointed a plastic spork at him. "Yeah, you look a little familiar," he feebly joked. "Come on, sit with us," Gordon Griffin offered. Eric hesitated. "Let's go." Griffin turned and walked to the back of the room. Eric had no choice but to follow him. "Slide over, Cody," Griffin told the lank-haired, weasel-faced boy that Eric remembered from the basketball court. "Eric's gonna sit there." "No, it's okay," Eric protested. "I can sit over. Just sit there, okay?" Griffin insisted. "It's the first day of school. You're the new kid, and you already look kind of pathetic. We're trying to be friendly here." He stared at Cody, who reluctantly got up to vacate his seat. Griffin blew the hair out of his eyes. "So," he said to Eric. Eric waited for more, but there wasn't any. He looked around the table. He saw another face he recognized, Drew P., and nodded. "Sup," Drew P. murmured, then capped it off with a yawn. Griffin rattled off a bunch of names, Sinjay, Will, Hakeem, Marshall, Pat, introducing Eric to the rest of the table. Eric nodded at everybody and got drowsy grunts in return. "So," Griffin began again, "what do you think of Belport Central Middle School so far?" Eric shrugged, eyeballed his lunch. "The meatballs look a little disgusting," Griffin suggested. "Soggy, green, inedible." Eric laughed, pushed his tray aside. He was hungry, but not that hungry. "It's not so bad here, really." Griffin frowned like he knew better, but didn't bother to disagree. "Middle school," Griffin repeated. "Where did they come up with that anyway? We're in the middle of what exactly? Too old for elementary school, but not big enough for high school? So they shove us here. Look around. There's not an interesting person in sight. Just a bunch of clones who want to be like everybody else." Eric nodded thoughtfully, signaling agreement. He kept his true thoughts to himself. He wasn't prepared to pass judgment on everyone in the school. Something caught Griffin's eye, and he smiled to a lunch aide as she passed behind Eric. "Hello, Mrs. Rosen," he said in a cheerful voice. "How was your summer?" "Oh, hello, Griffin," the woman replied. She was an older woman with black hair, around 50, small and trim and tidy, and she reminded Eric of a kindly mouse. She seemed pleased to see Griffin Connolly. There was genuine warmth in her voice. "You are getting so big," she noted. Ugh, every grown-up said that. Eric shot a look at Griffin, watching for his response. "Eating my Wheaties," Griffin replied, flexing his muscles and smiling. "How's that dog of yours? What's her name again?" "Daisy," Mrs. Rosen replied. Then her face changed. The smile dropped, and she looked 10 years older. "I'm afraid we had to put Daisy down." "Oh, too bad," Griffin said, putting on a sympathetic face. "Daisy was a great little dog." And so the conversation continued, the older lady conversing with dear, sweet Griffin Connolly. To Eric, there was something false in Griffin's tone. Too cheerful, too sweet. The wrong note. For 90 seconds, Griffin Connolly became the most polite, mild-mannered boy in Bellport. Strange. When she walked away, Griffin smirked at Eric. That old git's loaded, he said. I'm telling you, she has more money than Oprah. She lives around the block from me. I've done some odd jobs for her in the past. You should have seen that little dog of hers, Eric. It was one of those, what do you call them? Lap dogs that just barked and barked and barked. Stupid animal. I'm glad it's dead. The world is a better place. Eric didn't know what to say to that. Hey, Cody, Griffin called down the table. I'm still hungry. You see Hallenbeck around? Cody craned his long neck, made a quick survey of the room. He shook his head no. You want me to try to hunt him down, Griff? He offered. Don't bother. We'll catch him later, Griffin replied. He reached across the table and poured out a handful of Eric's chips. I'll just share with my new buddy. That is the end of Chapter 7. Don't forget to do your questions, and we will be chatting with you guys. Hope you have a good day. Bye.